writers, agents, and publishers, for the first time since the Gutenberg Press, find themselves lost in a maze of mystery as technology alters the shape of the publishing industry. Searching for Answers is a group of writers throwing pop culture, writing, and publishing into a crucible of clarity, passion, and humor. This group is the Write Pack. Welcome back to Write Pack Radio. This is your host, David Allen Lucas, author of science fiction and crime drama, and president of St. Louis Writers Guild. With me today is...
My name is Jennifer Stolzer. I'm a children's book author and illustrator, actually schooled as an animator, so I'm going to enjoy the topic for today.
I'm Matt McGraw. I'm an amateur short story writer, mostly. I also have a picture book called Patrick the Spider that Jennifer illustrated. If you're interested in books about spiders, or if you're interested in publishing them, let me know.
we'll talk more about that later.
We'll talk about that later, Brad R. Cook, the author of Iron Horseman, which is a steampunk adventure novel. And be on the lookout, because you're going to read a lot more about Iron Zulu coming up here soon.
That was my train sound for Iron Zulu.
I was hoping it was a werewolf.
I wasn't sure what that was.
I was just hoping it wasn't a Zulu sound. It's supposed to be.
No. I don't know what the sound Zulus made. Okay.
I'm Melanie Kalani. I am an author of nonfiction, fantasy, and science fiction.
Fedora Amos. I write Victorian whodunits, like Jack the Ripper in St. Louis. And I am president of Greater St. Louis Sisters in Crime.
And today we're going to continue with our Rules of Writing series, which we started back with Elmore Leonard. And this time it's going to be Pixar, 22 Rules of Storytelling. Brad, do you want to start off?
Well, I thought Jen was going
to... Well, actually, yes, Jen about the 22 Rules, and we'll turn it over to Jen to talk about Pixar is. So,
yeah, I'll try and be brief.
For those of you who probably listen to the Elmore one, I'm a fan of writing rules, and I have a bunch of them. So the Pixar Rules are an awesome series. They're originally tweets that Pixar put out, and then they have now been...
Compiled, good word,
into a giant meme that is funny and has the dog from Up on it. Anyway, turning over to Jen to give you more about Pixar.
Pixar is one of my heroes. Specifically, John Lasseter is one of my heroes, who was owner of Pixar. Now he's currently in charge of not only Pixar, but all of Disney animation in general. Because when Disney bought Pixar, basically they said, please come save us, John Lasseter. Have our soul.
Yes.
And John said, if you must. And then he saved Bolt. Because Bolt was going to be garbage. And then John Lasseter came in and went, no. We fixed this.
Thank you, John. I liked Bolt.
Yes. So, Pixar started as a software company. They were making computers. And
computers or computer software?
Both.
Okay.
Well, I mean, they were programming for computers. I think they had a hardware aspect. I don't know. Correct? I'm sorry if I'm wrong about that. But the point is, they started off with more traditional computer programming. And they programmed a renderer, like a 3D software renderer called RenderMan. And it made rendering so much easier that it elevated computer animation just, you know, tenfold. Like, wow. SIGGRAPH that year, they had a presentation that brought people to their feet, that they were just so amazed with what RenderMan could do.
I remember.
And that's what kind of led them into making animated shorts. They made a bunch of animated shorts. You know, the Luxo lamp that they use as their logo, that was their first short, was this Luxo lamp hopping around. It was a lamp that was on one of their desks that they just modeled and animated.
And for those of you that are a little bit younger, that was incredibly cute and unique and great graphics when it first came out.
Well, what astonished everyone when that came out was that they managed to evoke a character and a story with these things. Before that short came out, there were other ones trying, you know. Everyone was trying to further the medium. But 3D animation was mostly for technical stuff, you know, architecture and showing off renders of things, not necessarily trying to animate with them. And this was like a triumph that led them down the line into making Toy Story when they were they partnered up with Disney. Disney did not own them at the time. They were in a partnership. Disney owned the distribution rights for all their stuff.
Yep.
And they realized after creating a couple films that they could do that themselves. Mm-hmm. Split from Disney. That's Ratatouille. And then Disney said, I can't confirm this rumor, but Disney was going to make Toy Story 3 without them, because Disney owned the rights to the Toy Story characters, and John Lasseter said, let's talk about this. Mm-hmm. I don't want to see you guys use my characters in this way, and they came back and struck a deal in that he could also do Toy Story 3. So,
question for you, and this is a little bit of the animation history question. Was Pixar out, or was Pixar already in existence running its movies before Disney's Hunchback of Notre Dame, or was that after? And the reason why I'm mentioning
that... That was before.
It was before.
Toy Story was before.
Okay, I couldn't remember. Because I remember the story behind Hunchback of Notre Dame that Disney did, is it almost crashed all their computer systems when creating it. So that's what made me question that.
Toy Story came out, I believe, 91 or 93. I think it was 93. Okay. It came out in 93, and it took, like, 3 years to make, three or four years to make. They picked toys because they could render that sort of glossy plastic look much easier than they could humans. This is, you notice the humans look kind of like toys in that movie. And the reason that the mother was never seen was, you know, partially artistic, but mostly working within the limitations of what they were doing. Another reason to have toys. And it was based off of the, one of their earliest shorts was called The Tin Toy. It was about a little toy that gets stuck under the bed. And let me tell you, the baby from that short is nightmare fuel. It is one of the scariest things you will ever see moving toward you, and I don't blame that toy for hiding under the couch.
Googling that now.
Yeah, I just looked it up. Oh, Pixar started '86, and Notre Dame was '91, so yeah.
So, technically, they probably used the RenderMan software.
That's what I was wondering.
An early version of it, or maybe they were trying to write their own and had to graduate up. I'd look into that. That'd be interesting for me to research.
Okay, so...
Well, I was just going to say that one of the other beautiful things that Pixar has done is created these 22 rules.
Yes, let's get on topic.
And the reason I say that is we're going to go over them in a second, but I'm a huge fan of these rules. And the reason I'm a huge fan of them is because it really does help you in a guide towards keeping your story on track and ways you can improve, always improving. But they just have some really brilliant ideas in here about storytelling. And, I don't know, I use them as guides. So I use them at the end when I've written everything. I kind of go back over and I go to them. How well do I fit into the Pixar model?
Mm-hmm.
And especially as a middle grade writer and a young adult writer, it does help. It's a nice thing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Could Pixar turn this into a movie?
So what are the Pixar rules? What's our first one?
Before we do that, what's the attribution on that? Isn't it to one person?
Yes. It's to somebody named Emma Coates.
And is Emma Coates one of the really big wigs at Pixar?
Pixar's story artist.
Yes.
She's a story artist.
I don't
She's
know
not
what
a screenplay writer,
is.
A director,
like
a producer, right?
Yeah. They are the person who draws out the story.
Yeah, she's a storyboarder. She's more than a storyboarder, but storyboarding and series planning and stuff like that is one of her jobs.
Which, in essence, is visual storytelling. So,
sort of like planning out a comic book, perhaps.
Very much
it's
like a comic.
It's like
sequential drawing.
It's very much like plotting out a novel.
Uh-huh.
The only difference is, I'm writing everything down, and they're drawing pictures.
Right.
So you conclude that she actually speaks for Pixar, or is that she was doing this to increase her own visibility?
Oh, no. I believe that she was reporting what they do at Pixar.
Yes.
Like, from an informed position at Pixar, she was saying, these are the things that we think of when
but
we do
story
crafting.
But she's not a spokesman for Pixar, per se.
But Pixar has never denied these.
Not exactly. She's
Have
an
they
author,
ever confirmed
exactly,
them?
Anyway.
Yeah. The author is an employee there.
She's an employee in good standing. Let's
yeah, there you
that
go.
Way.
Yeah, I've seen her in the
she's
office.
She's an authority figure.
Yeah, after these tweets, she still had a job, so I'm pretty certain Pixar's okay with it.
Yeah.
So anyway, the 22 rules.
Yes.
Well, okay, here's the first rule. You admire a character for trying more than for their successes. That's you, the audience. You like them more for trying than for succeeding.
Yes.
So the idea is your characters need to be likable, or at least some of your characters need to be likable?
No,
I don't think
attempt.
It's likability.
They need to reach. They need, they need to reach out and attempt more than necessarily they will succeed.
It's a motivation thing.
Yeah.
They have to be driven.
And it's okay to fail.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is in essence what they're saying.
We almost like them more for failing sometimes because they put themselves out there.
And exactly.
We as humans respect people who take chances sometimes. I don't want to say all times. But most of the time, especially in storytelling,
yes.
And for a hero, we respect people that take a take a leap of faith.
Not necessarily a guy who takes his, you know, family savings and takes a leap on those with gambling.
Well, it's, yes, but what if he's doing that to pay his medical bills?
Ooh.
Or the medical bills of his wife or his child. You know, it's all about creating a compelling character.
But see, also then he's going to get that weird job where he's working in the back of the bakery, and then he's going to, you know, help find the little girl who's lost or something. You know, like, keep attempting different things to reach successes.
Refusing to give up on his dream.
Yes.
All right.
We're not.
Andrew Stanton, who is one of the big wigs at Pixar, a screenplay writer of WALL-E and one of the later Toy Stories and Up. He's also a producer, director. It's all, as I understand, sort of collaborative amongst the big wigs at the place. Well, at any rate, he has a wonderful video out, which is on TED, and you can find it easily just by looking for clues. You've seen it, I take it?
I have not seen it. I am not up to date on my TED Talks.
On your TED Talks. Anyway, he gave a presentation at TED, which was absolutely delightful, and has this to say about character. He used an example of Mr. Rogers, you know, from Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, and said that he always carried in his pocket a card, whether this is true or not, I don't know, but he said it, that he always carried a card in his pocket that said, "There is no one you cannot love if you know their story." And so there is no character you can't love either if you know their story or if the writer gets the story right.
Yes.
So make the character likable even if he's a terribly bad guy.
Yeah, well, everyone is supposed to be a complete story within themselves. We get to see a little visit of them within the plot of the book, but what brings them to life is that sense that they existed before the story started, and assuming they survive, will continue existing after the story ends.
Exactly.
Well, we should all strive to write more interesting people.
I'm always a fan of character. Character is my
favorite. Which kind of leads us into number two, actually.
Good.
Oh, you might. Oh, I don't think it does.
Because they're all over the place. And repetitious, too, I will add.
They are a little repetitious.
Okay, number two.
But they're getting you to look at different aspects.
You gotta keep in mind what's interesting to you as an audience, not what's fun to do as a writer. They can be very different.
And I would agree with that completely. There's times in which I've played with, oh, this is fun to write, this is fun to write. And then I finally sat back and I read it. I'm like, well, okay, that was fun to write, but I just bored the living daylights out of myself as a reader.
Well, what is an example of a scenario like that happening?
Backstory.
Backstory. Backstory is a good example.
I can say it in one word. He said it in one word. Prologue.
Backstory. Info dumps and backstory. You gotta love them, but the reader, not so much.
You work out all
the
stuff.
The plot couch.
Yes, the exposition couch. Exposition couch and the plot cul-de-sac.
Also, for instance, technical explanations. Especially like in sci-fi, sometimes you get technical explanations for how things work. Occasionally I find that really interesting. But oftentimes it's like, okay, it's sort of like on Stargate, the MacGyver character. What's his name?
O'Neill.
Oh, yeah, O'Neill. Thank you. Every so often they're giving those technical explanations like, okay, it's a zap gun. Let's go. You know.
Go ahead, and I got something after you. Go ahead.
Well, Andrew Stanton says that you have to make the audience work for their dinner. Don't tell them too much. And his bottom line on that was, it's always 2 + 2, never 4.
I like that.
I like how you said that. In fact, I'm going to add to that. That's not what I was going to say originally. I'm going to go ahead and go down that road in a minute, but... I had a professor a while back talk about, it was novels and novellas, I should say. But he was talking about a story, and the characters and the story are like an onion. You've got to keep peeling back more and more. More and more you peel, of course, more and more you want to cry. But that's exactly what you're saying. It's not 4, it's 2 + 2. It's the elements of that character or elements of that story. I forget what I was going to say originally. Anyway, go ahead.
So next.
Number three. Oh, I remember now. I'm sorry.
Not number
three.
Hang on. Here's another example of where it might be fun to write, but it's not, and we haven't really hit it yet. where it's fun to write but not very fun to read.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the technobabble, it's the beautiful babble, as
Purple Prose.
Purple Prose.
The Purple Prose. Oh, the Purpose. The sky was the elegant emerald, or emerald as the storm blew in upon its whatever.
You're looking at all your 18th century writers.
Yeah, exactly.
19th century writers.
Right, 1800s.
It's a genre, the literary-ish kind of thing.
They got
paid
by
really
the word.
Long sentences.
People who got paid by the word.
People got paid by the word.
And it's still around.
But I agree, yeah. I'm a child of my generation, and I'm aware, and I will admit it. I have a hard time reading the classics because I get bored of all the description. I often skim directly to dialogue because I feel like the story is going to be told between characters.
Yep. Okay, now number three. Sorry about that.
Number three. Trying for theme is important, but you won't see what the story is actually about till you're at the end of it.
Hmm.
Now rewrite.
Well, I agree with the rewrite part, but you don't know what the story is about. I don't understand what that even means.
Well, I think what it means is that the story you intended to write may or may not be the story you end up with, and more importantly, beyond the main plot, because that's probably not going to change. That's not what they're talking about, but the themes that you ended up writing into that book. You'll see them more at the end of the book when you finish writing, and then you go back through and kind of do it. For me, it's as I start writing, by the second half of the book, I have a very clear sense of the world and everything I'm writing. So then I have to go back and make sure the front half of the book maintains what the back of the half had.
Yeah, I'm doing my first rewrites right now. First chapter's like, oh boy, what is this?
Mm-hmm.
Last chapter, the later part, pretty close, it just needs improvement.
It's the difference between starting off writing a coming-of-age story. You think that you're writing about a character growing up, but really you're writing about a character letting go.
Mm-hmm.
Then you learn that by exploring your character and your story, and by the time you get to the end, you're like, well, he's still coming of age, he's still growing up, but the theme that I'm really exploring with this, that I've learned because I'm teaching myself as I write, is that I'm learning about letting go. And you go back and you make sure that note is a little stronger at the front end, but when you weren't thinking that way.
I think this is a great caution, and to one kind of writer that's out there, I call them the keep it in the box cause writer.
Hmm.
And what I mean by that is, I've got a political cause. I don't care. I'm not talking about conservatives, liberals, that. I'm talking about, for example, I want to write a book about
saving puppies.
Fine. I was going to
murdering children.
No. I was going to write a book about how important it is that we save the ocean. And that's my main theme. So my entire story, I don't care if my Jennifer character and my Fedora character are off on some little adventure that could be even greater story and greater aspect to the characters. No, they are not allowed to go. This is all about me saving the ocean. So they would pull them back in.
Star Trek 4, Star Trek 5.
No, I like Star Trek 4.
I like
4.
Star Trek 4 is my favorite.
But it was totally
I'll bring you an even more stark example.
Please.
I'm going to write a movie about a day when all birds and seagulls attack everyone and kill them and peck their eyes out.
The birds.
But I'm going to stop every 10 minutes and talk about global warming.
Oh, different story.
Birdemic.
Oh, okay.
Huh?
Birdemic Shock and Terror is a movie created.
Isn't it Shock and Awe?
It's Shock and Terror.
Oh, it's Shock and Terror.
Yeah, Shock and Awe was
another George Bush thing.
That's the George Bush movie, yeah.
Okay.
George Bush movie.
Birdemic was a movie that started, he made it because he wanted to make the birds again. The director, who, a man with much, much gumption and not a whole lot of self-awareness. but he,
But you don't see people as I'm bowing to death.
That sounds like a character sketch for some book.
He is a character. The way he got it, this is a tangent, but the way he got into, I think it was Sundance Film Festival, was he drove around with a bunch of dead birds taped to his car, and the sound of eagles blaring at the top of his radio, and a big sign that said, "Play Birdemic at Sundance." And they're like, okay, you went through that effort, fine.
Okay. Wow.
But it was a story he really wanted to make the birds again because he loved the birds, but he also loved the environment. And he didn't let the story about the bird attack be a story about a bird attack without stopping every 10 minutes to look at each other and talk about global warming. And it completely, it turns it into a joke. I mean, before, it was a joke anyway, because it was really, really, really low budget and very, very, very first movie-ish. But even though it's like its second or third. But it's, the point is that it turns it into a laughable. It's a classic of the bad movie genre because of this misguided sort of
I will say that not all Bible movies are about like that, but some of them are.
No.
I'll just say
Noah.
Oh, Noah.
All right.
Should we move on to number
four? Number four, which is actually a really funny one. Or, I don't know. It's a good one.
Number four. Once upon a time, there was...
Blank.
Every day.
Blank.
One day.
Blank.
Because of that.
Blank.
Because of that.
Blank.
Until finally...
Blank.
This is the structure of every Pixar story.
Uh-huh. Once upon a time, there was a toy. Every day he played with his boy.
No, every day he was toy. It's every the same blank each time.
Okay, one day...
toy.
New toy came. And because of that, he got jealous. And because of that, he tried to commit murder.
Yes.
I think it's because
of that. Until finally they became friends.
Exactly.
But yeah,
I love Woody. He's a great conflicted hero, isn't he? He actually does try to murder somebody in that.
Let's
movie.
Let's redo that for Toy Story for real here, please.
It was Toy Story for real. What are you talking about?
Let's do that. You said toy a few times too many.
Once upon a time, there were some toys, and every day there were some toys that were owned by a kid. Every day, the kid played with the toys. One day, a new toy showed up. Because of that, Woody got jealous and tried to kill him.
Yes.
Because of that, he had to go out and rescue him. Until finally, they were happy together with the kid.
Yeah, they became friends and were reunited with the boy.
Ta-da.
The end.
So if you need to structure your story, or in any way, shape, or form not certain what to do, it's a good sentence to start with. I wouldn't stick to it, because that's the Pixar model, and everyone will go... Wow, I just read a Pixar movie.
Yeah, I feel like I've seen this before.
Reads like a Pixar movie.
Yes.
It would fly right off the shelves.
Actually, probably.
It probably would, actually.
So stick with that model. It'll be a fast track.
But it can be a guide, a helpful guide.
Well, I think that is the fundamental kind of structure for plot for almost anything. Mm-hmm. But then, of course, there are a whole lots of offshoots that drive it in more interesting
directions. There are a lot more because of that.
Yeah, I think the important element to take away from this point is the because of that.
Yes.
Not the and then this happened. It's because of that, because that implies a cause and effect. Yeah. And that's where drama comes from. It's like, because Woody was jealous...
Therefore.
He... was separated from his kid and out with his friends, you know, like out in the outs with his friends and feeling isolated, and has to now try to reclaim his place as what it is, Andy's favorite toy. That wouldn't have happened if he hadn't become jealous and tried to commit murder.
Did he try and commit murder, or it's been so many years since
what he tried to do was knock Buzz out the window.
Yes. Yeah, okay.
But it's more fun to say commit murder.
Yes. Okay.
Because that, it was a... He expected him not to come back.
Exactly. It was an entire thing arranged about him not coming back.
Yes.
He wanted him to get sold.
No,
he wanted him to be gone out the window.
He was knocking him out the window to break him or to at least lose him.
Yes.
He wanted him gone. He was going to rub him out.
Doesn't he push him off with the side with the kid who's like horrible and does horrible things to toys?
I don't think he...
Or is it the other side?
No, he pushes him out that window.
Yeah.
I don't know if the intention was for Sid to blow him up, but I'm sure that consequence would not have been rejected.
Exactly. Sid, that's right.
Sid the evil kid.
Yes.
Okay, number five.
Number five. Simplify, focus, combine characters, hop over detours. You'll feel like you're losing valuable stuff, but it sets you free.
Very true.
E.
The combining
Cummings.
Of characters thing.
Yes, and that's the plot cul-de-sac.
Yep.
You're getting rid of that little roundabout that doesn't go anywhere just because it's fun, just because you love Tom Bombadil so much that you've rescued him from the toilet when your son Christopher tried to flush him because he hated him so much, and you put him on your desk. Does not mean that he belongs in your epic fantasy novel, but you put him in anyway because you love him. But it's still a plot cul-de-sac.
So plot cul-de-sacs are sort of like side quests in video games.
Yeah, it's not affecting anything about the main story. It's just fun filler.
Yeah.
Which you have to recognize before you can do anything about it, and that's the really hard part.
Yes.
That is hard.
Which is something you can see at the end of your story more easily than you can when you're writing it.
Of course.
You can see where, you know, the main storyline's going along, and then all of a sudden, boop, they popped off somewhere else. And it's like, well, did I really need that?
Yeah.
And if not?
And it's a dead end. It didn't really go anywhere.
No.
Because if it goes somewhere that you're trying to go, that's okay.
Yes, exactly.
I like to think about it. And this goes also for the Pixar model or whatever. I always like to think about if my book or a movie,
mm-hmm. yep.
I try to cut down the number of sets I have to build and the number of people I have to hire. Because
mm-hmm.
if you can, if a great example, my own book, you know, I'm writing it, they used to go to this extra, like, that when they were going to learn about their epic quest or whatever, they went to a hotel and they stayed in the hotel and they were met at the hotel by the wizard or whatever who gave them their marching orders. And I realized one day, why do I have this hotel? This hotel does nothing and is pointless. Why don't they just get their marching orders at the place they are already at? And it made a tighter first couple chapters for me and probably elevated the writing enough for people to maybe be interested in it a little bit more than if they'd randomly bopped off to some other place for no good reason.
Yeah, now, right now I'm making this decision. I have, my main character has two brothers,
mm-hmm.
and I'm trying to, and the main character has a best friend that's not really in it all that much, and I'm trying to decide whether or not I should condense the best friend and the brother into one character.
According to the Pixar rules, maybe that would be a good idea.
Yes. It's a possible yes. idea. The one reason not to do it possibly is because there's right now there's the best friend has a romantic interest in the brother.
You'll so feel like you're losing valuable stuff, but it
good
sets
point.
You free.
Ah. Yeah, it sets you free. All right, so should we move to
yes.
Yes.
Number six?
Number six.
Six. Number
I
six.
Like that. Was good.
That's good.
Yeah.
That
was good.
Let's see. Number six. What is your character good at and comfortable with? Throw the polar opposite at them. Challenge them. How do they deal?
Mm-hmm.
That's yeah. really the basics of drama, isn't it?
You it know, is.
Take yep. somebody, put them in a situation. Oh, no.
Yeah, kick them out of their comfort zone, and now they've got to swim when they instead of drown.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Horror and we can watch them drown. That's an interesting story.
Yeah, horror stories of drowning.
But so take the toys out of the room.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Hide under the bed from the nightmare baby.
Andrew Stanton calls that finding the spine of your main character. Because all well-drawn characters have a spine. It has that person has an inner motor, a dominant unconscious goal that they're striving for, an itch they can't scratch.
Uh-huh.
And that I love. Itch they can't scratch. They keep trying. They keep trying. And they don't even understand what the itch is or why they can't scratch it. But they keep trying to scratch it.
It's interesting. I have another character in my story. I have to think about if he has any unconscious motivators. Because he pretty much knows what he wants, I think. But, you know, we'll see. Well,
what they think they want, such mm-hmm. as money, for example, may not be at all satisfying once they get it. So
well, that's
it wasn't
true.
Really what they wanted or what they needed, for
exactly.
sure. Unconsciously.
When I build my characters, there's always that, I always have that question, is what is it that they say they want,
mm-hmm.
and what is it that's underneath that they really want?
Mm-hmm. All they really wanted was to be loved by their mother.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
that's why they had to put her in a chair after she was dead.
Thank you, Psycho. Number
yes.
seven.
Number seven.
This is a good one.
Come up with your ending before you figure out your middle. Seriously. Endings are hard. Get yours working up front.
Excellent. Because
yeah.
I don't know what the middle is right now, but I know what the ending is.
There you go.
Well, it gives you that thing to write, too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The black moment. Gotta yeah. have it.
Yes.
No, the black moment's mm-hmm. not at the end. That's in the middle.
No,
but the end is
that's
easy
the
after the
end
black
is the
moment.
Dark moment, the climax, and the aftermath. It's not mm-hmm. the actual end.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, like, most things have an epilogue these
yeah.
days. Not a lot of people just cut right at the climax.
Well,
yeah, we're not talking about the
long.
Little clip at the end of the Avengers.
Yeah.
What we're talking about is the dark moment of the Avengers all the way to the credit reel.
Right.
Yeah.
And then it's the ending of your character story,
yeah.
really.
Yeah.
It's what your character is working for, where they're headed to, and that's what helps you write them along that way.
And by knowing that dark moment, knowing that climax, knowing where you have to go, that middle becomes a nice road that you're writing instead of this weird forest that you're trying to get through.
Or it becomes an odd series of islands that you hop from place to place, but you know kind of where the next island is located, so you can confidently shoot in that direction and hope
you find
it.
You got a boat, you're good.
Okay, next one. I'm sorry, I'm going to jump this because I just looked at the time.
Yeah,
yes.
we ramble
God.
A bit.
Eight. Finish your story, let go even if it's not perfect. In an ideal world, you have both, but move on. Do better next time.
This is true.
Yes.
You
Very
can only
edit
so
us.
Many times.
There's a military term called polishing the cannonball. That means that you're trying to... it's hilarious.
This,
it's,
yes,
you're
it's
lining up the perfect, most perfect shot. Nope, not quite there yet. Not quite there yet. You need to dang well fire your gun by
yeah.
now.
Yeah.
So that's what that's going for. Okay, number nine.
Number nine. When you're stuck, make a list of what wouldn't happen next.
Wow.
Lots of times the material to get you unstuck will show up.
Hmm.
It's a good habit. It's a nice little trick if you are stuck, you get writer's block, something like that. come up with 1,000 ideas that won't happen, and I guarantee you somewhere along there, the one that will work will totally work into your brain. I just had this happen, actually.
Have two gunmen bust down the door and come in with guns blazing.
Elmore
Leonard. Yes.
Is it things that would happen or would not?
Would not happen.
I'm reading it, but I'm listening too, and I'm like, if I heard that at home, I was.
You're not thinking of possibilities you could possibly use.
Exactly.
You're thinking outside the box and letting your mind flex a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great tip because it's like it's really practical advice. It's right down to it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, number 10.
Pull apart the stories you like. What you like in them is a part of you. You've got to recognize it before you can use it.
Mm-hmm. Well, that explains Cyrano de Bergerac, The Scarlet Pimpernel.
This is a brilliant thing for all writers to be able to do because it will allow you to see what you need to see in your own story.
Learn from somebody who's really good. It's a secret there.
Amen.
Break apart the best. Break apart Harry Potter. Break apart these great novels that we've all read and that everybody's read and figure out what's great about them.
And also break apart the really bad ones and find out why they're bad.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. You can do both.
And I'm going to actually, in a way, combine what you two just said. If there's a novel that you super love, somehow it's just touched you, has gotten to you, you can't get rid of it out of your mind, but yet no one else is really reading it, break it apart. Find out what it is about it that's touching you.
Well, every good thing is not a perfect thing.
No.
I mean, even on a subjective level, you take apart something that you really, really love and look at the way you would have done it if it was yours.
Mm-hmm.
It's dissecting things is great fun. But then, of course, I learn through that kind of a thing, a deconstructive learner.
You are. You're very good at deconstructing.
I like this. I really, really like that. I love deconstructing characters. I love deconstructing plots because I like to take the face off the clock and see how the little bit is going.
And I have a new webinar here that Jen can do called Deconstructing with Jen. Okay.
Yeah, I'll do it.
Number 11.
Can it all be about Babylon 5?
Number 11. Putting it on paper lets you start fixing it. If it stays in your head, a perfect idea, you'll never share it with anyone.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Amen.
Okay, number 12.
One thing about number 11 I'm going to say, and this is something I run into personally, I think a couple other writers have done it, like Hemingway, is don't talk about your story until it's done.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you've released all your attention for it.
I don't know.
But I agree with number 11.
I think it depends
on
person.
Who you are.
Yeah.
If you want to shut me up about my story, it'll never get written.
Yeah.
I get all of my energy from sharing it with people. Sorry, everyone at the table.
I'm really the opposite. I've learned the second I'm really starting to talk about the story, which is why I'm shutting up recently about my current project,
mm-hmm.
the tension behind it to get it out the door is gone.
Mm.
I've got to keep my mouth shut on it. So anyway, number 12.
Number 12. Discount the first thing that comes to mind. And the second, third, fourth, fifth, dash. Get the obvious out of the way. Surprise yourself.
That's really good advice.
That is very good.
And that will help you surprise others, which is an important point, because you need to mingle drama by using anticipation, mingling it with uncertainty. That's another Andrew Stanton.
Okay.
All right. Lucky number 13. Give your characters opinions. Passive malleable might seem likable to you as you write, but it's poison to the audience. I think that's something that got goofed by a Twitter character limits.
Oh.
But being passive or malleable might seem likable to you as you write, I think is what she means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Didn't we already talk about that in an earlier one?
Sort of, but this is about writing strong characters who have strong opinions as opposed to...
whatever.
It's part of making a character intriguing or interesting.
It is.
But sometimes I'll speak from an informed position as an illustrator. Often my clients have a hard time letting their characters have strong emotions. Like, they're afraid that if their lead character gets too angry or too sad, that it will make the audience too angry or too sad or be frightening. And it's frustrating to me, having gone through these rules, having learned a little thing or two about storytelling. I know it's picture books, but little kids watch these movies, and they respond to these movies, and they resonate because the characters inside those stories experience their lives.
There's a reason why somebody almost dies or dies in every Disney movie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's because that's, you know, you have to touch someone deeper than they were anticipating. If we go in for a nice bland time, we might as well watch Barbie's Day at the Ballet. And then we remember nothing about it. Because the worst conflict that happens in a movie like that is she doesn't make it into the ballet.
Yes.
And we're not scared of that. We might feel for her at the time, but it's not lasting. Having a character have a strong opinion or a strong position to come from that may not be the author's opinion gives them just that little bit of fire that makes them feel a little bit deeper than, you know, mm-hmm. Barbie.
And I was just being sarcastic. That just stopped. Okay, number
14.
14.
Why must you tell this story? What's the belief burning within you that your story feeds off of? That's the heart of it.
Hmm.
I'm not sure like I understand. Huh? No, I just don't understand what it means.
No, they're asking, and it kind of goes back to earlier about at the end of your story, you'll know what your story is about. But in essence, what they're asking you to know is what is the essence of your story? Not the main plot. That's not what we're talking right. about here. We're talking about the main oomph of your book. If you look at Toy Story, it's about the relationship of toys to the boy and toys to each other. Mm-hmm. And it's also about letting go. And moving on from childhood into, you know, that's kind of the overall themes or whatever.
Uh-huh.
That's kind of what they're going for. Every book's got one. And knowing that is a huge, like, marketing and ability and, you know, knowing where your novel can go and how you can affect people, how you can, you know, emote. But, yeah.
What's the pulse of the story?
Exactly.
Good point.
Well, and also for anyone who has, like, multiple ideas of, like, things they want to write, you know, what's... Why did you pick this one out of all the ones you have on your back burner to actually work on?
And why are you the one who should write it?
Yep.
All right, number 15. Uh-huh. If you were your character in this situation, how would you feel? Honesty lends credibility to unbelievable situations.
That's reasonable. Put yourself in your character's shoes.
Yeah, get your acting chops going.
It'll also help you... understand and relay how the emotion of the character is supposed to be. Not only just the reactionary, but also the internal, you know, feelings and motivations that you might not, that your character might not share vocally or, you know, through body language or something, but they're still experiencing it. And if you can put that in there, that's greater depth to your character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
you
have to feel it in the first place. Exactly. And in fact, I think we feel something for all of our characters.
I hope so.
And that's why we write them.
Yes.
Of course. I have a deep passion for my characters. All of them, even the little guys who show up on a couple of pages.
It's hard, though, when you're writing a character that's supposed to be rather detestable.
Well, that's what acting is for.
Well, I always say this. My two favorite things in the world are characters I love and characters I hate.
Uh-huh.
Because if a character does something or an actor does something to where I hate them, where I despise that person beyond anything else in the story, that's huge. That's making me feel emotion. That's making me have reactions. That's making me have all this kind of internal stuff that I'm impressed with. So though I hate that character... I'll end up having some sort of love for that character and that actor simply because they made me hate them.
Of course, but the point I'm trying to make is the way the character is supposed to feel about that action is different than the way that I feel or the way I expect the audience to feel.
See, and I don't even mind that because then, you know...
Well, I don't mind that. It's just different than the, you know, different than the rule.
Well, it's the rule is about trying to become, you know... Inhabit your character's mind.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So when you're writing that character, you do feel the way that they do because you are them at the time. Mm-hmm. And then when you're done writing them, you look back and go, boy, that guy's an ass.
Yeah, this character doesn't care about anything beyond himself. So it's like, yeah.
I guess William Atherton's the actor? The guy from Die Hard?
Oh.
the guy in the first one?
Yeah, Ghostbusters?
Yeah.
That guy. Oh, that guy. Love you, dude, because you're awesome.
Did a good job. Made you feel something.
Made me hate you in almost every movie. That's
huge. What an asshole. All
right, next.
Number 16. What are the stakes? Give us reason to root for the character. What happens if they don't succeed? Stack the odds against.
Yeah.
Yep.
It is great to let your reader know what the horrible thing that would have happened if they fail. Because it's... One, it allows you to explore that area of, you know, ultimate depression or ultimate badness or ultimate whatever. But then the beauty part is that the audience now knows what the stakes are.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they're emotionally invested.
I think I have to work on that. That's act two.
The most basic situation for that kind of thing is, I think Alfred Hitchcock used to talk about this.
Mm-hmm.
The guy hanging off a cliff. Mm-hmm. You got somebody holding on to somebody else and they're hanging off a cliff. Stakes are really, apparent there. Yeah. If he lets go, that person's going to fall and splat on the bottom and be dead.
Yikes.
So that's, you know, when you're watching a scene like that, it's super tense. Yeah. And that's why the movie Cliffhanger is awesome. Is that what it's called? The one with...
Sylvester Stallone up in the mountains? Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
You went from Hitchcock to Stallone. I was like, wait a minute. I had the image of...
They both made movies. I mean...
North by Northwest is the one I was picturing.
I'm forgetting the book that invented the cliffhanger. I read it in 11th grade, which doesn't help anyone at this table because no one went to high school with me. but it's an American author... it was a Wild West novel. It wasn't Dancing with Wolves, but it was in that genre. Natty Bumpo. Might not have been him, but that author.
You got Lonesome Dove. I'm not sure where you're going.
But in any case, in one of the chapters ends with literally someone hanging off the cliff. And then the next chapter is from a different perspective, a different scene completely. So that was
the first guy to ever write a guy hanging off a cliff.
Cliffhanger.
Wow.
Well,
I can't even imagine.
It was the first time that the cliffhanger was used in that way.
Good point.
Yeah.
So it became, it's the same way that, you know, I refer to something as being the exposition couch.
Yes.
It's because I read a book that was so distinctly that it became the term that I used for everything else.
And besides, this doesn't count the serials. That the serials might leave the person hanging from the cliff, but then the very next episode of the serial explains what happens.
There's a fantastic cliffhanger in Toy Story 2 when we're watching the TV show that Woody came from, and he literally rides Bullseye off, he jumps a ravine, and then it's like, tune in next time to see if Woody makes it, and it was canceled. So it's ultimate cliffhanger for Woody's Roundup.
Yes.
Wow. Woody was really pissed off because he's watching his own adventure. He's like, how will I know if I make it?
All right, so number 17. No work is ever wasted. If it's not working, let go and move on. It'll come back around to be useful later.
Mm. Yeah, I think Wally was put in the drawer for quite a while, and then they came back and finished it.
Well, I think what this is actually referring to more is the sense of if you write a plurilogue, if you write a character sketch, mm-hmm. if you write a whole 10-page document on who your character is, that's not bad.
Yeah.
Doing that is not wrong. You know, doing that is improving your writing, and somewhere along the way, something out of that will filter into what ends up being your book or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
From a personal point of view, most of you around this table know I worked on a project and saw multiple different versions of it for several years, and that was something I promised myself I would never do. And I got hung up on it so bad that I didn't get anything accomplished.
Mm.
But there are still elements in it, and I recognize those elements that may appear in another story.
I just recently had the unique experience of going back to some really old fan fiction I wrote in high school, late high school, early college. Still a huge nerd, but back then I was writing a lot more fan fiction than I was original work. And I'm trying really hard to have the original work outweigh the fanfic, but depending on the season, you know, that's how it goes. But I went back to a bunch of really old ones I had, and I was going to punch them up a little bit and move them to a new site because I was still proud of the work. And I noticed as I went through all of these repeating scenes, stuff that was in Threadcaster that I did not remember, that I had prototyped in this fanfic, and it was something that I felt worked, I guess, that stuck with me even in a subconscious level. But that scene is like one of the big scenes in my novel. Similarly, one of the books started with a sentence that was near identical to my current opening sentence in my work in progress. I did not remember that. It's crazy. But all of that work I did, all that work that, you know, my father at the time told me was pointless because it wasn't sellable, and it was all fan art and just fun stuff that's just dumb. Well, that stuff prepped me for doing something greater later.
Let me point out something, though. It actually... something to keep in mind, there's this thing called plagiarism, and it's really easy to do it by accident, and what you just described is one of the main reasons why it's so easy to do it on accident.
Even though it's an homage. Plagiarizing ourselves, yeah.
Yeah.
It'll be an homage.
but the point
to
is...
To yourself?
Well, in the case that it would seem like plagiarism. If someone pinned me down and said, hey, you just accidentally copied the ending to Catcher in the Rye, you didn't realize you did that, I'm like, oh, sorry, homage.
Okay.
So, number 18. Know thyself. It actually says, you have to know yourself, colon.
But know thyself is better.
You thought you'd punch that one up a little.
Yeah, she could have saved on characters.
Exactly.
Like,
judgment.
Okay. Colon. The difference between doing your best and fussing. Story is testing, not refining.
Mm. Okay. So it's permission to make mistakes, really.
Yes.
Know yourself. Didn't we have know that the difference between... Kind of. Between... Let go. What? Know the difference between doing your best and fussing. So it's you've done as well as you can at this point, and the more you mess with it, you're not gonna. It's the practice of changing words.
Yes.
Without changing meaning, you're just trying to make it better all the time, and you could just let it go. It's okay.
To requote myself, stop polishing the cannonball.
Yes.
Stop polishing the cannonball.
Told you they were repetitious.
A little.
They are, but they're trying to look at the same thing from different angles.
Yeah.
Number 19. Coincidences to get characters into trouble are great. Coincidences to get them out of it are cheating.
This is the best of their rules. Sorry.
I was, that is something that I adopted I didn't even realize came from here. Or
yes.
Maybe it was a similar adoption from somewhere else, but that's one of my favorite rules to tell people, and my favorite rules to scream at movie screens
yes.
while I'm watching films.
Oh. There is nothing more frustrating than the convenient out.
Yeah, the deus ex machina.
Ah. Which is a phrase I can never say.
Deus ex
We tried that.
Machina.
You can go back, you can listen to some of these episodes.
But, I love a movie now.
Yeah.
But, it is.
One author I know that is actually good at breaking that rule, because he does it very ironically, is Douglas Adams.
Douglas Adams is a fantastic demigod, so
yes.
We can let him do things.
Well, I mean, he uses that deliberately because he likes writes
like
funny,
I said,
so
he's doing it ironically.
Yeah.
He undercuts his own story with mm-hmm. doing that.
You're expecting something silly to happen.
Yes,
you know?
And that's where you know the rule and you know how to break the
Correct.
Rule.
Yes.
Correctly.
Getting close to the end.
Yeah, we're very close here.
Yeah.
20, exercise, colon. Take the building blocks of a movie you dislike. How do you arrange them into what you do like?
That's a fantastic, fun thing to do.
Is it not?
Okay,
I love
doing
that.
Hand me Star Trek Into Darkness. Okay, no, I'm just joking.
You can hand me that. I got plans for it.
Well, didn't we do that? What movie were we doing that with?
I'm not sure, but one of the prequels, there were some things that...
It was... Sorry, go on.
Oh, I was just thinking a Star Trek... There was a... Not Star Trek. Star Wars. There was a scene where Amidala was...
On a couch?
Possibly.
Most likely.
Yeah, and a point is Obi-Wan Kenobi jumps out a window to go... He acts
yes.
impulsively.
Yeah, it was
and someone
backwards.
Yeah, and someone else figured out, wait a minute, this is the wrong thing to do. It should have been the impulsive Anakin jumping out that window.
That's, I'm going to give that one to Red Letter Media's Plinkett Reviews.
Yes.
And also we had a discussion also similar, not to that particular scene, but the other scene in Attack of the Clones, where Anakin is trying to seduce Amidala or admit how much he loves her, and it's like, and she's going, I can't be with you. I'm a senator.
Yeah.
Like, the whole entire dialogue is in reverse.
Absolutely. Two characters written opposite.
Yes. So you mean I can't marry you, but we can bang on the side? That's
Except
what it
that
should be with
his doctrine
senator.
Says that he can't have any emotions at all.
Right.
And
yeah,
he's the one begging for sex. It doesn't make any sense. No, I was saying, do you remember when we went to, it was a Riff Tracks movie, Jack the, like in the Giants or whatever?
Oh.
Yeah,
oh, yeah,
and we came out of that movie saying, that had a promise, and you were going to be like, I'm going to write a novella that's going to fix everything. And it sparked this great discussion that we had, that you had like an outline, that you planned all these things, that you could take this stuff that they'd set up in this
Jack...
I think
you still have this somewhere.
Yeah, this whatever the name of that film was. It was a terrible
Jack
movie.
Jack the Giant Killer?
No, that's a different movie.
Okay.
Also bad, but for different reasons.
I think it was that, actually.
It was a...
It was like Jack the Giant Killer or something.
It was a low-budget... past, you know, like dying movie theater movie, you know, passed into public domain and now used as a Mystery Science Theater episode.
Yeah.
Nice.
But yeah, it had something to it, and I thought I could figure it out.
And it was really cool to look at a Lego set. Like, you buy a Lego set that's supposed to build a race car, and you see all the parts you have, and you build it into a helicopter instead. It's that kind of thing.
Spaceships.
They all became spaceships or dinosaurs at the end for me, anyway.
So, number 21. You gotta... Oh, jeez. G-O-T-T-A.
Ugh. You gotta
identify with your situation / characters. Can't just write cool. What would make you act that way?
Didn't we already do this one?
Well, this is about not making your character the coolest guy at school.
Yeah.
You know, like he slides in on a skateboard, kickflips it out the window, sits down without looking.
Yeah. It's acknowledging that your characters are human beings.
Yes.
You have to make them relatable.
Yeah.
If you're going to make a cool character, which you can, you know, you just have to... There has to be something kind of reasonable behind it.
Fonzie was the coolest character ever.
Until he jumped a shark. Literally.
Well, yes. Well, he was the one who jumped the shark. There's another example
he
of the cliffhanger.
He created jump the shark.
That was where jump the cool shark came from.
It's like
but
Chuck Norris.
He was super cool, but he was also the most interesting character because hidden below, well, at least in the later season, hidden below that coolness, we were learning a lot about how he was kind of a loner. And although he's older than all these younger kids, like he's still kind of like suffering a little bit. For some deepness that Happy Days managed somehow. But he could still use his fists to start the jukebox for free.
All right, number 22, our final rule. What's the essence of your story? Most economical telling of it. If you know that, you can build out from there.
So is that your log line?
That sounds like your log line.
So no, your blank meets blank and blank. Elevator pitch?
Most economical telling of it, I guess, would be the elevator pitch.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 30 seconds. What is it about?
Mm-hmm.
Does any elevator take 30 seconds?
If it's going to an upper floor, you know.
Depends. Well, you have to leave time in there for you to actually get up the nerve to talk to the person in the elevator.
Well, no, but he's saying, does the elevator ride actually last that long? And
the answer is
it definitely can. You could be, like, stopping on different floors,
This
too.
Was also created back when elevators took a little bit longer. We didn't have the express elevators that, like, shot up to, like, you know, a certain floor.
Yes.
Back in my day with the springs.
Yeah, I got cranking it.
Well, I'm back to Andrew Stanton, and I think that this list leaves out the most important thing that he had to say.
Ooh, bring it on.
The very most important thing, the bottom line for Pixar, which is invoke wonder. Mm. Isn't that great? That is great. It really is. Get people to find something about the mystical, mysterious world that is worthy of wonder, no matter how old, how jaded, how much you've done everything before.
You know, in all honesty, I'm going to have to go with that because let's think about this for a second. Jen, you started off writing what? Fanfic, right?
Oh, yeah.
The whole entire part of fanfic.
Yeah, go on.
The whole entire point of fanfic is you want to put you, the reader, who happens to also be a writer, wants to continue to play in whatever universe you're playing in. Look at Star Wars, look at Star Trek, look at Harry Potter, wherever.
Well, look at the state of films nowadays. Like, how many movies are coming out that are remakes or retellings?
Amen.
It's like 1985 again or something?
Yes.
88 or something?
Yeah.
Like, all the same movies from, like, 1988 are coming out again this year or something strange like
and
that?
Yeah. They're not trying to invoke
wonder.
No.
Dear 1980s, I grew up in you. I do not want to see the fashion come back. Thank you.
I just came from the mall.
Late.
It's too late.
Yeah.
Maybe the cocaine could come back.
It's always been
too late.
Now it's heroin. Catch up.
I thought it was methamphetamines.
It's heroin.
Only because you live in Missouri.
St. Louis is heroin like
burned.
Crazy. Anyway, off on a tangent there. But
you almost said Mars, didn't you?
Off on Mars, they're doing lots of cocaine.
It's red, though.
Red rock. Okay.
This has became an interesting tangent.
We're no longer on
back
Pixar.
To the original thing, though.
Yeah, you think they do cocaine at Pixar?
The element of wonder.
I'm going to say no, because I'd like a job there one day.
The element of wonder is very important. I mean, without it, well, you leave your stories flat.
When you run the risk by saying what's the wonder element of ignoring the fact that the wonder has to originate from an actual, like,
real
germinated
story?
Seed.
Yes.
The wonder's got to come up from a place that feels natural. Because if you put it in just to be cool, then you're violating.
Well, I don't think it's possible to put in just to be cool.
It's entirely possible to put things in just to be cool.
Things in, but can you put wonder in the heart of your audience, your reader?
Well, you can think you are.
You can think
that's
a
the
lot
goal.
Of things. That doesn't make it so.
I think this is the deal. You have to refine your story to the point that it strikes a chord. But if you go into it writing saying this is going to strike a chord, you run the risk of shooting a little too far.
Yeah, I think the wonder thing is definitely a rewrite issue, not a starting out issue.
A lot of these were rewrite rules, though. So.
Yeah.
That's their process. You know, they have a creative, you know, if you think about the way that Pixar works, so a team of people generate an idea. That team of people then creates the structure of that idea, the story of that idea, the characters of that idea, and then, you know, more people get added in, they start animating, so it's a constant revision process that they're in. Unlike a writer who, we write it out and then we do a couple revisions. Mm-hmm. They are in a near constant state of revision.
I'm in a constant state of revision.
Yeah, I mean, it happens. Once you get to the editing part.
Yeah,
we have all that
even before
front matter.
That.
But this is writing by committee.
Yeah, well, a lot of it. Well, it's for
production.
Every production, you know, like especially, it depends on the studio, of course. But
we all wish we had this.
Often they have a showrunner that has the final say, and they take into consideration what everyone's saying, and then that person gets themselves kneecapped by the production. Mm-hmm. Disney comes in and says, "You're not allowed to do this, this, and that thing." Or
the applesauce salesman.
Yeah, so there's that element too to telling stories, and at this point, you know, it's like, I don't know how much time we have left.
You got time.
We got time. Let's talk about Pixar in general as like a company and how they've utilized these rules. Mm-hmm. They do definitely have a formula now.
Yes.
And the formula is growing a little wearisome as they sort of kind of copy-paste it to their less attentive movies. They obviously have movies that they put their full A-team on. And then they have planes. And stuff like that.
There's a clear money-making.
It's like there are the ones that are going by the books, that are following the rules but not taking time to analyze and bend their own rules. And then there are movies like Up, you know? We talked about Up before. Up had the self-awareness to make us cry in the first 10 minutes. And it was beautiful, and everyone remembers those first 10 minutes because they experienced an entire human life in 10 minutes, and it felt real. And that was the element of wonder that they created Mr. Fredrickson. Mm-hmm. And now we knew everything about him. We knew where he'd come from. And that wasn't something they'd done in one of their previous movies. And I'm going to pull up my rant on Toy Story 3 real quick, which I think I've already had. But Toy Story 3 tried to recycle things that they'd done in previous movies. If you look at the bad guy character, Lotso the teddy bear, he has a near identical moment that as Jessie the cowgirl in Toy Story 2, where he sits down and has real talk with our characters, and we learn about how he was loved by a child and then abandoned by the side of the road in a sepia tone past scene, while some woman draws sadly over it in a really, you know, supposed to be a poignantly touching scene. And they're so similar. In Toy Story 2, I will be the first to admit it makes me cry every single time. The Jessie story, when she's telling it, and she's telling it in this way, and the song is so beautiful, and it fits so well in that movie that it just hits me right in my heart. When Lotso does it, it feels like he's rehashing Jessie, because he does not have the same thing that Jessie's character does. He does not have the same sense of sort of self-awareness and purpose and vigor as Toy Story 2 did in that way. That's the difference between just following the rules because they work and understanding the rules and implementing them. So I'm guessing, yeah, I'm bringing up, you know, other Pixar movies to apply these rules to, so you can see how they kind of echo each other and look and make a note of when they go through and look in their own workbook and decide, as they revise their story, what has worked in the past, what's kind of a redo, what's not fitting for the tone, what revisions they can make to make each movie its own movie, and how well or how not well they happen to do that is up to your interpretation. My interpretation is I scream about how I feel about Toy Story 3.
Now, I will say that Pixar, in general, cares about having a story that in general makes sense. And it seems like some movies, it's like, oh yeah, let's do that because it looks cool. Like, who cares that if you think about it at all, the plot doesn't make sense, you know?
They have their share of those two. Cars 2, John Lasseter pretty much admitted he did it because he thought it would be cool. He probably will write me an angry letter if he ever hears this and say, I certainly did not. But I do remember distinctly an interview he had where when he was trying to think of what to do for Cars 2, he was thinking specifically about what toys he wanted to play with.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he wanted to make a bunch of cool stuff for little boys and girls to play with and to think about. And that was his motivation for that movie. Did it make a very good movie? No, it made arguably Pixar's first flop film. But, you know, that's because he was not trying to make a compelling story. He was thinking about what it would be like if Mater, the Larry the Cable Guy car, was in Milan. Uh-huh. That's exactly what he was thinking. He got the inspiration when he was touring on Cars 1 and going to all these different film release parties all over the world, and he's thinking, Mater wouldn't fit in here. What would it be like if he was here? That would be funny. And I would love to have a car that turned into a helicopter or a plane or a submarine and flew around and was a spy. And it's like, oh, we'll just combine these ideas and we'll make Cars 2 and it'll be super fun. And that was him making something for the sake of making something cool. So it's possible to do. And sometimes there's a place for that, and the place is on the kids and family rack.
Wow.
Well, I think
it's true
that Pixar does a really good job of investing the audience in the characters and making the audience care. Look at WALL-E, for example. You know, I don't like animated films just from the get-go. But I watch WALL-E. And I especially don't like machines that are supposed to act like people. I especially don't like
we
that.
We really can't
oh,
speak
no,
anymore.
Oh, no, I know. We
you
probably
definitely
can't.
Don't read the story on
I had no idea this is who you really were on the inside.
I really am. However, I can be swayed because when I watched WALL-E, and there's this new, wonderful, beautiful little computer and another old broken-down computer that so much wants to make WALL-E love him that, you know, it got me right mm-hmm. here. I couldn't help it. So I think they do a good job of creating characters that people care about, no matter what the characters are.
Mm-hmm.
Probably some of the most memorable characters of the last 10, 15 years are Buck and Woody. You were saying the guy from Up. I mean, come on, the dog who runs
Doug.
Squirrel, yeah.
Doug.
I mean, you know, I mean, these are literally the most iconic characters we have.
And Finding Nemo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Aren't
Nemo. Those lovable characters?
Sequel's coming out. Finding Dory. We'll see how well it does.
Okay.
I know that Ellen DeGeneres is very excited about it, though.
I'm sure she is.
So, if anything, she will do a fantastic job as recreating Dory.
I think overall, just to kind of bring this to a close, as well as any future topics we have on these writing rules series, I think overall is there's so many storytellers out there, so many really good ones. Elmore Leonard, rest in peace. Pixar, I can keep going. We've just covered these two, but learn their rules as an author. If you're especially if you're a brand new author, if you're trying to figure out, Roy, what is it I'm doing? How did this person do this? I want to be able to do this. Sit back, try to see if you can figure out the rules, or maybe they were kind enough to post them somewhere and hunt for them, find them, and see if they fit you. If they don't fit like the glass slipper in Cinderella, find another Cinderella.
Mm-hmm.
And on that note, I bring you
perfect.
Have a great week writing, and thank you for listening to Write Pack Radio. We'll catch you next week. The new theme songs for Write Pack Radio were written and performed by Meredith Tate. All copyrights remain with her. The Write Pack would like to thank STL Books for allowing us to record in their bookstore. STL Books and Gifts is St. Louis's newest independent bookstore with an emphasis on fine literature for adults and children and the most comprehensive selection of St. Louis books available anywhere. Visit them online at stlbooks.com or in person at 100 West Jefferson Avenue, Kirkwood, Missouri, 63122. Tune in next week as the Write Pack will conquer yet another pondering issue in the writing industry.